Hey folks, welcome to the channel. So the following video has spoilers for the first book of Dune, Nier Replicant, and Steven Universe. There's also discussion of police brutality in Empire, some gnarly messed up hand imagery from David Lynch's Dune, and a depiction of the Holocaust from an X-Men movie. In any creative writing class, you learn a few rules. The first is show, don't tell. When your protagonist is sad, don't just say she is sad. Have a garbage bag rip on her way to the dumpster, and instead of cleaning it up, she just lays down in the filth. Next, use concrete action. Just listening to an internal monologue without anything happening physically will confuse and bore your reader. And then, don't perspective hop. If you have a first-person narrator, stick with that narrator. If you have a close third-person narrator, follow just that character. If you have an omniscient narrator, do that consistently. Choose a place to write from, and write from that place. I finally read Dune for the first time recently, and I was surprised to see just how flagrantly it broke all of these rules. The dialogue is rich with subtext and implication, but then the narration explicitly tells you what the subtext and implication is. Long stretches of the book are expository politics or navel-gazing or a sort of psychic action sequence that only has the barest physicality. And the perspective hops constantly, sometimes just switching the point of view for a chapter, but often swapping from paragraph to paragraph in the same passage. Let's look at the famous Pain Box Gom Jabbar sequence early on. In it, Paul Atreides, ducal heir and nascent protagonist, is subjected to a painful test of his resolve by the Reverend Mother Gaius Helen Mohiam. Basically, Paul has to keep his hand in a torture box, and if he takes it out, he'll be killed. His mother, the Lady Jessica, is terrified for her son, but as a former student of the Reverend Mother, she complies with the strictures of the test and waits outside so that Paul will not be interrupted. The most conventional way of writing a scene like this, some sort of scary, high-stakes rite of passage, is from the point of view of the person undergoing the rite. They're the one most intensely feeling the stress and uncertainty of the situation, and sticking with their perspective puts you in the character's shoes. So, unsurprisingly, a lot of this passage is from Paul's perspective, both during the uncertainty before the test begins. Paul looked back at the Reverend Mother. Politeness and his mother's obvious awe of this old woman argued caution, yet he felt an angry apprehension at the fear he sensed radiating from his mother. And during the agony of the test itself. Pain throbbed up his arm. Sweat stood out on his forehead. Every fiber cried out to withdraw the hand from the burning pit, but the Gom Jabbar. Without turning his head, he tried to move his eyes to see that terrible needle poised beside his neck. He sensed that he was breathing in gasps, tried to slow his breaths, and couldn't. But we also get paragraphs from the Reverend Mother's perspective, not just describing how she acts, but cluing us into her internal monologue. She blamed it on space travel and association with that abominable spacing guild and its secretive ways. But here was a mission that required personal attention from a Bene Gesserit with the sight. Even the Padishah Emperor's truthsayer couldn't evade that responsibility when the duty call came. Damn that Jessica, the Reverend Mother thought. If only she'd borne us a girl as she was ordered to. And then, when Paul's mother Jessica returns to the room, we get things from her perspective. Jessica stepped into the room, closed the door, and stood with her back to it. My son lives, she thought. My son lives and is human. I knew he was, but he lives. Now I can go on living. I'll admit, my first reaction to these sudden shifts was something like, teacher, Frank Herbert broke the rules. At this point, I'm so used to these axioms of storytelling that my response was pure instinct, even if I know I should know better. There are plenty of works of art that use these exact sort of shifts to great effect. More than that, though, Dune makes it clear early on that these shifts are not a sign of amateurism, but thematically relevant. Paul has gone through the pain box ritual in part to test if he's the Kwisatz Haderach, a messianic figure who is so good at taking drugs that he can see all existence from both a masculine and feminine perspective. Putting aside the questionable gender politics of this concept, it sets the theme for the story very well. It's about point of view, a hero's journey in search of a better way of seeing, a vantage point to see it all, from every angle, all at once. But that's not how perspective works. In both written and visual arts, perspective is the idea of choosing one place at a time from which to view things, which necessarily privileges one position over others, creating a dynamic of the viewer and the viewed, and leaving much out of the picture. Perspective is a powerful tool for creating the illusion of depth and narrative, but by applying the metaphor of vision to how we talk about art and power, we apply vision's limitations as well. and so I want to explore how perspective works in media, which perspectives we favor, and what it leaves out, in search of new ways of seeing, from different angles, from all angles, and perhaps beyond angles altogether. One of the first rules you learn in film school, I'm assuming, is the 180-degree rule. There are tons of really good videos about this that I'll link in the description, but basically it's the idea that film makes the most spatial sense to a viewer if the camera stays on one side of an imaginary line for the duration of a scene. If an establishing shot puts a character on the right and another on the left, staying on the same line will keep those characters on the right and left respectively, while crossing it gives the sense that they've changed places. The rule helps orient eye lines to give the viewers a sense of what the characters are looking at, even when the object isn't on screen. More broadly, it gives the fictional world a kind of geography, if not geometry. You have a general sense of what the environment looks like and where the characters exist in that environment. Even when parts of that space aren't shown, our brains trick us into filling in the gaps. A clear and consistent perspective gives the story a stable space. In other words, it helps a film seem natural, like it's not film. Of course, like any storytelling rule, it can be broken to varying effects. It's often used to show disconnect or unease or some sort of shift in the narrative. My favorite scene in X-Men First Class, because it's the only good one, has Kevin Bacon trying to draw out a young Magneto's latent powers and get him to move a coin. It's a tense scene, and to start it follows the 180-degree rule. Magneto on the left, Bacon on the right, and an axis connecting the two of them. When it cuts to close-ups of each character, they're still clearly in the same space, and their connecting eye lines reinforce both the actor's position and the fictional space in general. This continues for as long as Kevin Bacon is trying to win Magneto over with kindness. Eventually, though, Bacon decides a more aggressive tactic is necessary, and he rings the bell to bring in some Nazi guards. And as he does this, the film breaks the 180-degree rule, jumps to the opposite side of the line, and reveals the torture chamber that's been there the whole time. This choice in cinematography is jarring, but that's the point. The camera reorients itself just as the narrative reorients itself. This is so effective because it uses the sense of stability the previous scene had developed. It's a kind of architectural jump scare, unsettling the audience by showing us this place is not what you thought it was. It's not the terror of a door suddenly appearing in your home, it's the horror of realizing you've just noticed a door that's been there for years. A lot of the time, when film intentionally breaks this rule, it's doing something to this effect, conveying a change in the story by startling the viewer with a change in perspective. And that a change in perspective is so startling speaks to both its power and limitations. A clear point of view is foundational, orienting a tiny cosmology to make the illusion of story feel briefly real. But with every place the camera looks, there's a place it does not. Whatever it focuses on, something can sneak up from behind. Honestly, though, this isn't really the effect Dune is going for by shifting perspective so often. For that, though, we can still look to film for a way of understanding it. In Studio Binder's video on the 180-degree rule, they say that a line through the characters works great for two people having a conversation, but obviously that won't work for every scene. When the action gets more complicated, it's time to treat it like a stage play, establishing the axis as a line between the audience and the actors. This accomplishes the same thing the rule usually does, keeping the relative position of the characters separate while building fidelity to a fictional space. In this context, though, breaking the rule takes on an extra dimension. If the inviolable line is separating the viewer from the action, the real from the fantasy, then to cross it is literally breaking the fourth wall. A quick bit of background, just in case you're not familiar with the term's origin. Breaking the fourth wall refers to when a work of fiction in some way acknowledges that it's fictional, be that making jokes about the genre conventions it's following or addressing the audience directly. The term gets its name from live theater, where the story is constrained by four walls, the back and two sides that separate the stage from the backstage, and an invisible fourth between the seats and the scene. If a story's character is moving from the box of drama to an observer's perspective who knows that the play is a play, then they're breaking the fourth wall. So when a film crosses that axis, it's subtly drawing attention to the fact that it's a film. Staying on one side of the line lets the audience develop a sense of place for the scene, but the disorienting change in perspective disrupts that sense, reminding the viewer that the place they're imagining is, in fact, imaginary. Even more than that, when characters are suddenly on opposite sides of the screen, your brain makes sense of it by considering where the camera is, and by considering where the camera is, you're considering that there's a camera at all. The audience gets an oblique view of the story's artifice, a look into the techniques the film is using to create its fantasy. While not exactly the same, Dune's shifts in perspective are also breaking the fourth wall. Now, I'm not saying that this is super blatant and the new movie's gonna come out and Stilgar will say that Shai Hulud is a Fremen word for two-thirds of a movie's budget, but the story is deliberately asking you to recognize the stories that it's weaving, and the perspectives from which it's weaving them. We see Paul from his parents' perspectives, and he's Paul Atreides, heir to Duke Leto, beloved son and political project. We see him from his partner Chaney's perspective, and he's Usul, the private name given to him by the Fremen tribe that took him in. We see him from the perspective of the United Fremen, and he's Paul Muad'Dib, prophesied religious savior and rebel leader. And we see him from his enemies' perspectives, from his followers, from histories, and he's simply Muad'Dib, the warring messiah. By seeing him from each of these points of view, we get a better sense of Paul as a character, but we also clearly see the limits of each of those perspectives. No one view shows his entirety, especially because many of Paul's identities are at least somewhat artificial, deliberately constructed public personas designed for strategic advantage. There's the regular posturing of politics, cultivating a certain image among his adherents, but then there's stuff like the prophecies he's fulfilling having been planted by operatives across the galaxy so populations would be easier to control. In fact, a lot of Paul's internal conflict is how he can control his myth in the making. As Muad'Dib, he's at once a religious figure and a military leader, and his drug-granted prescience tells him that's a fantastic combination if you want to start a centuries-long holy war. The war, called Jihad in the book and very deliberately not called that in the 2021 movie, follows from Paul's revenge on his enemies, but becomes something separate and more horrific, a galaxy-spanning conquest in the name of Muad'Dib. To prevent the war, Paul is actively trying to shape the story he will inspire, to fight against the viewpoint that he's an avenging savior come to set the universe ablaze. Early on, Paul has a premonition of taking the name Muad'Dib among the Fremen, though at the time he doesn't know what that means or who these people are. Later, the premonition comes true, but he changes it slightly, instead taking the name Paul Muad'Dib, trying to maintain a kernel of himself in the haze of myth. But controlling that narrative is harder than it looks. No matter what Paul does, the crusade comes closer and closer to reality. When he goes to ceremonially ride a sandworm, he muses that whatever happens that day, it will become part of his legend. If he succeeds, he'll be remembered as the greatest worm rider to ever live. If he dies, he'll be martyred for the cause of the Fremen. The content of the story is subservient to the perspective of it. Paul is viewed as a messiah, and so anything he does is messianic. This speaks to the incredible power of perspective, but also its falsehood. It's a type of deception, and that deception can be particularly dangerous when one perspective dominates all others. By the end of the first book, that's exactly what has happened. Paul has just achieved a stunning military victory, a ruthless political power play, and a bloody triumph in a duel to the death. But in doing so, he has surrendered, not to any of his many foes, but his own myth. He has become the Muad'Dib, the chosen one who brings millennia of conquest. He has given up on trying to wrest control of the camera. Instead, he takes its lies and lets them be real.
The process of seeing paintings or seeing anything else is less spontaneous and natural than we tend to believe. A large part of seeing depends upon habit and convention. All the paintings of the tradition used the convention of perspective, which is unique to European art. Now, perspective centers everything on the eye of the beholder. It is like a beam from a lighthouse, only instead of light traveling outwards, appearances travel in. And our tradition of art called those appearances reality. Perspective makes the eye the center of the visible world. But the human eye can only be in one place at a time. It takes its visible world with it as it walks.
That's John Berger from the landmark film Ways of Seeing. It's a discussion of the tradition of European oil painting and what it says about art, politics, and commerce. I'd really recommend it. It's all on YouTube, sections are half an hour apiece, and the links are in the description. He's talking about perspective in painting, the technique popularized in Europe during the Renaissance to create the illusion of three-dimensional depth on a two-dimensional canvas. It works as he describes it. The painting takes the position of a single eye, angling and sizing the figures to fit that eye's point of view. Much criticism, artistic, political, cultural, over the last century has been about whose eye that gets to be, and who is seen. To borrow terms from grammar, it's a question of who is subject and who is object, the one watching and the one being watched. The second installment of Ways of Seeing looks at the tradition of the nude, how it's an unabashedly a male perspective on female bodies, and how it tries to exonerate itself by displaying the woman as aware of their voyeurs and being kind of into it. The painters are choosing a deliberate angle to paint from, and they're using the content of that painting to justify this angle as natural and good, which implicitly argues that this sort of perspective is good outside art too, both reflecting and shaping broader cultural attitudes. To show this, the second half of the video is a panel of women discussing how this dominant perspective affects their views of themselves, that they look at their reflections like the voyeur in a nude, internalizing the tradition's artifice and skis. At roughly the same time as these films are released, Laura Mulvey is coining the term the male gaze in her also landmark essay, Visual Pleasure in Narrative Cinema, which I'd also highly recommend. Some of the psychoanalysis stuff is... but it's beautifully written and a lot deeper than just saying cinema is often from a man's point of view. She talks about how the male gaze is serving two distinct functions, the scopophilic, or just the sexual pleasure of looking at someone as a sex object, and the ego ideal, or a male character the viewer can identify with as an idealized version of themselves. She argues that the male character, because he is an active force in this fictional world, needs to appear convincingly in three-dimensional space. The female, though, as object, does not. Horny close-ups of individual body parts create a sense of flatness, the illusion of perspective fading away. In a very literal sense, women are not allowed to be three-dimensional characters. All they need to be is canvas. In each of these cases, we see the very real political ramifications of perspective. The orienting eye is necessary for the illusion of depth, but too often that eye is the culturally dominant one, using its monopoly on the image to reinforce and justify its own dominance. The two examples I've listed here focus on women, and overwhelmingly white women, but a similar issue of perspective disparity has, of course, been used to analyze race, queerness, cisnormativity, and ability, intersections thereof. The dominant gaze fulfills the same basic role in each case, using the marginalized as an object, an other, and the dominant view as the ego ideal, the eye from which to watch. A rich 3D subject and a flattened 2D object. But things are getting better, right? With increased focus on representation, both in creations and creators, there's an unprecedented awareness of whose story we tell and who does the telling. The advent of the internet and rise of social media allowed marginalized voices to move past gatekeepers and present their perspectives directly. The idea of a mono perspective, one single, stable subjectivity that everything else follows, is dead and buried. Things are great, right? Things are great! Things are great! In the first episode of Ways of Seeing, Berger talks about the visual language the camera has made possible, and all the new grammars film has made possible. But, he says, though this is a language, it's not yet a conversation. So long as film and television remain a tool of the elites, most of us will never be able to respond to what they're saying. But John, I have some fantastic news for you. YouTube! YouTube has solved your problem. Now anyone can participate in a conversation using the language of the image. Everyone gets to be the eye of perspective. The revolution of the camera is complete. We live in a democracy of the image. And it's all thanks to YouTube, the greatest tool for equality in the history of the world. So, at this point, we're all pretty cynical about the good YouTube does for the world, right? I mean, it's a platform that's radicalized countless young men because fascism is great for engagement. It pushes regressive conspiracy theories and targeted hatred. It's become a haven for those most nakedly and viciously advocating for oppression. It has this almost utopian promise of giving everyone a voice, and it has become one of the most driving forces of supremacy in modern society. What, essentially, gives? To understand YouTube's apparent contradiction, I'd like to talk about perspective in video games, because it offers a similar possibility. Whereas painting has static viewpoints, and film has a dynamic viewpoint that you, the viewer, have zero control over, video games usually let the player control the camera in one way or another. The eye of video games is not the game's director, it's whoever picks up the controller, and they can point that eye in whichever direction they choose. This pure visual freedom is limited, though, by a development team putting a tremendous amount of effort in directing players to the same objects at the same time from the same angle. Even open-world games entice players with formal map markers or more clandestine points of interest, turning the game from a dauntingly infinite set of possibilities to a more manageable multiple-choice option. And once a player goes to one of those points and completes some sort of quest, they'll be directed to the next point of interest and the cycle continues. MMORPGs have this process down to a science, presenting a world where you can go anywhere and do anything, but you'll still be drawn along by a string of quest hubs designed to whet your appetite for achievement while constantly promising more. I'm not saying there's anything necessarily bad about this. In fact, there's a good case to be made that nudging the player along like this is necessary to creating a coherent story in a medium where the protagonist can jump off a mountain at any time. But it does limit in practice what's visual anarchy in theory. If the developers have given players total freedom but effectively lured them to the same objects for the same reason and from the same direction, even playthroughs by wildly unlike people will end up with the same image on their screen, perspective and all. There are many eyes, and each one is unique, but through the dopamine rush of accomplishment, the sedate thrill of controlled conflict, the constant promise of something more, those eyes can be made to occupy the same space. Of course, I am also talking about YouTube here. There are no literal map markers, no true quests, but an endless stream of righteous anger and vindication can be similarly alluring, bringing all sorts of people to the same place, uniting myriad perspectives into a single dominant one. We see the platform's radicalizing effects in Brazil, where the country's right-wing populist president slash wound man rose to prominence on YouTube, riding a wave of viral fascism. The situation in America is similar, with a motley band of alt-right creators consistently doing numbers. And through YouTube's incredibly effective recommendation system, 70% of view time through autoplay recommendations, that narrowing perspective gets even narrower, taking viewers, a lot of whom are young and easily impressionable, closer and closer to overt Nazism. Once a viewer has started down that rabbit hole, the algorithm just drags them ever deeper. This begs the question, why doesn't left-wing YouTube have the same success in radicalizing kids, but for stuff like universal healthcare and free breakfasts? Officially, YouTube does not favor one ideology over another, and generally speaking, I believe them. It's just that right-wing grievance cosplay drives engagement. There are the hate watches, the response videos, but overwhelmingly, it's people coming to watch them earnestly. It makes sense. Conservatism, and especially conservatism and the endless culture war stuff we're always doing, mixes righteous anger at loony lefties and an insistence that both you and the system, as is, are totally fine, assuming you're a cishet white guy. It functions like quest chains in video games, an illusory and self-perpetuating conflict, one in which the viewer is never in any real danger and victory is nearly assured, and finishing one video just leads you to the next. And by telling their viewers that things are basically fine, that inequality is inevitable and even good, these videos have the same effect as the smiling nude woman serenely getting creeped on, the dominant perspective using its dominance to justify itself. Meanwhile, leftism is less inherently comforting. Our enemies are not, I don't know, recent trends in embarrassing teenagers, but centuries-old empires and their defenders. While we can vindicate the woke, a meaningfully radical point of view is necessarily going to challenge things we take for granted. In Mulvey's essay, she calls for a death of pleasure, so long as that pleasure comes from patriarchal ways of looking, and anything that means less pleasure is automatically a hard sell. Perhaps even more than that, leftism calls for a proliferation of viewpoints, an analysis of the same event through countless angles of marginalization. There's no single, unified, official story the way there is in fascism. That's very much the point, but it still makes it a worse Skinner box. There's a whole other discussion here about the PR tactics of socialists that I'm nowhere near ready nor qualified to have. But at the very least, we can see the way right-wing authoritarianism works in the digital age, how a hegemonic perspective can maintain itself when viewpoints have been democratized. As a funnel among infinite options, a black hole of comforting cruelties. Like Dune, the Nier video games are explicitly engaging with the idea of perspective, and like Dune, they announce this very unsubtly in both mechanical and narrative ways. Normally, Nier is a third-person action RPG with a dynamic, floating camera you can manipulate as you'd like. Sometimes, though, the camera will lock into place and by doing so, shift the genre. Here, the game becomes a 2D side-scroller as the camera positions itself horizontally from the player character and temporarily eliminates depth as a spatial dimension. Other times, the camera takes a distant position above the action and turns it into a twin-stick shooter. Then the camera fades away completely, and you're playing a text-based adventure. What's interesting about these changes is that they're not neatly cordoned off from the main gameplay. Plenty of titles will have mini-games that disrupt your usual play patterns and perspectives, but there's usually a loading screen, introduction, or some other clear line between this disruption and the main loop to let you know that they're separate. In Nier, though, the transition is seamless. The side-scroller, the twin-stick, the text adventure, all of it is part of the main game. The same content, it just feels different due to the angle of approach. Unsurprisingly, then, the games are all about seeing things from a different perspective. In Nier, you play as a guy trying to save his younger relative Yona from a magic disease, and in your single-minded pursuit of this goal, you slaughter vast swaths of shades, glitchy little monster buddies you blame for Yona's illness. Your quest pits you against Shadow Lord, who I think is in charge of the shades, and seems to have plans of his own for Yona. You kill him, despite the fact that Yona mistakes him for you, and you're briefly, sadly reunited with your sister or daughter before canonically causing humans to go extinct, but that's sort of in a codex file. But since this is a Yoko Taro game, you play it again, and this time you can understand the language of the Shades, who were, and I'm sure I'm not going to blow any minds with this revelation, actually humans all along. Along with this additional text, you're shown scenes that recontextualize a lot of the fights you've already gone through. A nondescript face knight boss is shown to be an endearing protector of the smaller shades, and he only fights you to save his new friends. A giant wolf who kills a sympathetic princess on her wedding day has an origin story of the kingdom brutally killing his pack. And the robot-slash-shade combo you fight because you thought they killed a kid are actually a heart-wrenchingly adorable pair who were just in the wrong place at the wrong time. But here's where Nier really twists the knife. You, the player, gets all this new perspective that completely changes how you view this world, but Nier, the character, doesn't. He's still fixated on saving Yona by killing as many of these shades as he possibly can, and the fact that you can hear their very human cries of pain has no impact on him. The boss fights don't change. You don't have the choice to lay down your weapons and understand each other. The violence of this world, set into motion long ago, cannot be stopped, even when you know where it's headed. I'm reminded here of Alfred Hitchcock's famous description of suspense, how a conversation that ends with a bomb going off gives you seconds of shock, but move the camera to the other side of the table, and showing that ticking bomb gives you minutes of dread. This idea is usually used in example of the power of perspective, how a change in vantage point completely alters how the scene feels, but it also speaks to its futility. A different point of view leads to the same outcome. Facing the timer or looking away, the bomb still goes off. Tumblr popularized a focus in media criticism on representation of marginalized groups. It takes the objectively correct position that images and mass media both reflect and shape cultural attitudes, and because of that, improving representation becomes a vital step towards a more equitable culture. In recent years, we've seen more and more resistance to this focus, or at least some of the attitudes that often come with it, but I think it remains an important angle of analysis. First of all, our current media landscape, which still overwhelmingly values cis-het white male perspectives, is doing active harm, especially to children. Minimal, negative, or stereotypical representations of people of color is linked to higher rates of implicit bias in white audiences, and even worse, poor representation helps internalize self-loathing for the people it's portraying. By contrast, complex and positive representations foster positive self-image for the marginalized and empathy from dominant social groups. These benefits alone make this a conversation worth having, even if it does sometimes turn into didactic behavior modeling and treating the entire enterprise of making art as functionally a PR move. But like most worthwhile things, increased representation in media gets co-opted by capital. Captain Marvel is the first film with a female lead in the MCU, and it's also an extended commercial for the United States Air Force. Black Panther not only centers black characters and black creators, it shows one of the most compelling figures of black militancy in recent pop culture. But it makes him a murderer of black women named Killmonger. There are the same justifications of this as there are of rainbow capitalism, that it's better than the alternative, that it's progress, etc. But as the largest media company in the world mixes better representation with defense of empire, it shows the thin line between being represented and being marketed to. That's because mass media representation, while important, is still ultimately a symptom. The reason that stories of cishet white men have dominated American culture for so long is because cishet white men have dominated America. The shift in media representation has not brought with it a commensurate shift in power. The hierarchy allowing other perspective space is a symbolic concession to maintain dominance in other forms. Researching this topic, you find a massive body of work showing the negative effects of our biased media representation, but only a handful of studies on the effects that positive representation can bring, because, though there is some improvement, there is not the fundamental change we need. We can see the bomb, but it will still go off. I want to talk about Steven Universe here because it's become kind of synonymous with Tumblr's fandom as liberation deal, and also it makes for easy B-roll. Honestly, I've always really liked the show. It manages a surprising amount of emotional depth for a children's show, its cast of characters is fantastic and fully realized, and it manages to feel gentle without feeling simple. It's also a pretty significant step forward for representation in children's media. The showrunner, Rebecca Sugar, is bisexual and non-binary. Most of the main characters are queer women. The show's world is rich with families outside the narrowly defined 1950s nuclear image, and those families are presented as loving and vibrant, even as they run into problems of their own. In an interview for the LA Times, Sugar lays out that their goal with the show is to change perspectives. They say, "Gender is such a huge component in so many cartoons. It's just built into the DNA of cartoons. Who is it for? Right from the start, I wanted to address that by turning a lot of those ideas not just on their head, but just into the soup that it should be, because that's more realistic. And I really wanted to do this through cartoons because the semiotics of gender in cartoons have been so powerful of a force." Here, they acknowledge the role media, particularly children's media, and particularly cartoons, has played in enforcing strict cultural narratives about gender, while also presenting media as a solution to that problem by breaking those narratives up. The soup they describe is the manifold ways of looking we've been discussing, and the show seeks to accomplish that through representation, showing so many different ways to exist in the world that the viewer can't help but let go of old, dominant prejudices. This method is, as they say in the interview, coming at it from a position of love. This plays out in the series itself, where Steven usually doesn't stop his enemies by fighting them, but by empathizing with them until they see things differently. I usually quite like this. It makes the fight scenes indistinguishable from character development, and when Steven is connecting with someone wounded and lashing out, that kindness feels important and appropriate. But then there's the resolution to the show's main plot, Steven confronting White Diamond, absolute leader of the intergalactic gem empire. Visually, the scene is unsettling and effective. White, consisting of all the colors, positions herself as the true and perfect narrative, and she enforces that narrative through imperial expansion and, more concretely, turning other characters into freaky color-drained mouthpieces. She is the crushing mono perspective, and Steven is desperately trying to get her to see things from another angle. When White refuses, though, instead pulling Steven's gem, don't worry about it, from his belly to prove that he's actually his mother, don't worry about it, the camera fades to black. When it returns, we see things from Steven's blurry first person, grasping at the gem that was taken from him. This image, though, only takes up half the screen, and we soon see why. Steven's gem has taken on a life of its own, a bright pink copy of him, and the other half of the screen is from his perspective. We see both at once, Steven regarding Steven, applying his greatest power, empathy, to himself. What was meant to vindicate White's worldview instead fractured into other ways of seeing. The rich, multi-angle view. The semiotic soup Sugar mentioned. This is great! Love this! The thing I'm less enthusiastic about, though, is that this display eventually convinces White Diamond she's in the wrong. White Diamond's powers are necessary to undo the corruption she herself unleashed on the universe, so it's not enough for Steven to know himself. He has to, and this is the name of the episode, change your mind. He succeeds, White goes about making reparations, and the Diamond Authority dismantles their empire off-screen. I do think the final season of Steven Universe addresses this more explicitly, but I haven't actually seen that yet. So anyway, for a kid's show, this is fine, but trying to apply this idea to any of the many real-world examples of empire, and it starts to get fuzzy. The power of empathy and persuasion, so compelling on hurt people hurting people, feels fantastical when applied to the ruthless ruling powers. In this view, justice is achieved by appealing to the better nature of tyrants, which is something that's happened all of never in human history. It becomes the gentle, soft, small bean equivalent of debate me, coward, fighting fascists not in the marketplace of ideas, but the marketplace of emotions. What works for educating children, showing different points of view, fighting implicit bias, is naive and woefully insufficient to stopping the people in power right now, making sure all the old injustices stay current. Someone certainly could make the argument that nonviolent political movements have won real political power through empathy, but in the cases of the Civil Rights Movement or the Indian Independence Movement, the strategy was never about appealing to the conscience of segregationists or the British Raj. It was at least as much the disobedience part as it was the civil, disrupting business-as-usual politics until it was easier for those in charge to make concessions. You need only look at MLK's approval rating at the time of his assassination, he was one of the most hated men in America, to see that the lasting effects of the movement was not in how white people felt, but the laws that were on record. Representation was not enough. There needed to be a shift in power. I'm not saying any of this to discredit people working towards better media representation, because I think a lot of the people doing that are also advocating for changes in material conditions. I'm saying this to discredit me, or people like me, who are foremost critics and most susceptible to the appealing lie that we can simply art ourselves into a better world. That there is no distinction between the representation of power and power itself. That all we need to do is get people to see things from a different perspective. Walk a mile in someone else's shoes, and our broken world can heal. But here we must look to the wisdom of a Hot Topic bumper sticker. That to walk a mile in someone else's shoes just means you're a mile away, and you have their shoes. When we talk about perspective in painting and film, we often call it a visual language. That choice of words speaks to the interesting parallels between the visual language of perspective and the language of language. Near, as unsubtly as it is about perspective, is about language. There's the indecipherable shade speech that becomes understandable on subsequent playthroughs, there's the section where all graphics fade away and the game becomes a text adventure, there's the major character who's a book. Language in Nier fulfills the same role as perspective, creating a foundation on which to set the world, literally so in the text adventures, but also dividing people. Only able to understand other human remnants, the main characters get to believe they live in a world where they're the clear heroes and the shades are uncomplicatedly evil. The shades, unable to understand the human speech, are in a world where they're mercilessly hunted and they don't know why. The player, given perspectives and translations of both, can cross that divide, but for the characters in this world, the fragmented language mirrors the fragmented points of view. It calls to mind the story of the Tower of Babel, a human race united, linguistically and politically, joining together to build a tower to the gods and struck down for their arrogance, made to speak different languages and separated as a result. It's a chaotic and fractured world, then, where human progress is stymied by human division. Nier's world is similarly divided, not just between the humans and the shades, but even the humans themselves, with the Eyrie walling itself off from other cities, and the Desert Kingdom speaking a Japanese the rest of the world has forgotten. This is a world in discord, and it is one of tragedy, catastrophic misunderstandings, and needless suffering. But it's worth noting that the alternative has its own problems. The Tower is a story of empire, of a single, extraordinarily powerful nation building the one true way of seeing the world with the one true way of speaking about it. The all-seeing perspective aligns with all-knowing language, and rather than creating an equitable world of fair exchange, it all converges on a single point of power, an official story so reified it reaches the gods. We see something like this in American hegemony, the proliferation of American English, a sole superpower defining the narrative for all humanity, an all-seeing tower. We see this sort of tower with the language in Dune. Within the story, the human race is unified in politics and tongue. All humanity exists within the Padishah Empire, and while there are indigenous languages, for the most part, everyone understands each other, united by this one overwhelming authority. And the secret society of the Bene Gesserit have planted code words and religious tropes through the galaxy to manipulate people as needed, making a common lexicon that's used to reinforce the ruling class. In this far future, even as humanity is spread across the stars, there is one defining empire, one defining language. And in the meta-narrative, Herbert is doing the same. He pulls from modern languages, mostly Arabic but some Hebrew and Greek as well, that fit the story in modern geopolitical terms. The Fremen are quite explicitly inspired by Arab Muslims. They're a semi-nomadic desert people who lament being denied the Hajj, and this acts as shorthand for the contemporary Western reader to orient the story. A particular note is the word jihad, which has taken on a different connotation in the decades since the book's publication, but is always played into an imperial Western perspective. Dune tells us the story of a far future human civilization, but it tells it in our tongue, from a perspective we find familiar, using shorthand we know. Paul's last name is Atreides, a name taken from the Iliad, reinforcing the West's claimed descendants from ancient Greece. and the Muslims are exoticized and exploited, sitting on massive natural resources and forged into armies for other people's conflicts. Here we see the idea of subject and object on the macro level, a Western imperial point of view so powerful it permeates the universe, and an Arabic other that's both orienting and orientalizing. For the Western reader, there's the ego identification of a feudal European power structure and the scopophilia of sci-fi Muslims who are different in a familiar way. This is a story far, far in the future, but the power dynamics and linguistics haven't much changed from the time of the story's publication. The Tower of Babel has not fallen in this universe, instead extending its perspective unchecked. That devouring lighthouse Berger described, a cone of sight consuming all it sees. And though, by the end of that story, there is a different tower, it still swallows the stars. But if Dune is a story about the primacy of one perspective, the Imperial and then Muad'Dib's, Nier's is about fragmentary perspectives, and while its fractured world is a pretty terrible one, there's something beautiful to it, too. The game's soundtrack uses vocals far more than the standard video game score, but the vocals are not in the game's native Japanese, nor localized to English. Instead, they're made-up words from what they're calling Chaos Language, reasoning that if the game is set 1,000 years after the fall of human civilization, the remnants won't speak the same way we do. We, the audience, don't understand this chaos language, that's the point, but we still know how it feels. The vocals, the instrumentation, the pain and yearning in the words go past words themselves. The emotions it evokes are so recognizably human that we don't need a shared language to feel it ourselves. For a sad, fleeting moment, we don't need a tower to unite us. We're together in tragedy, amongst the rubble. In Dune, Paul leads a successful rebellion against an evil empire, but he doesn't dismantle the empire. He puts himself in charge of it. There's a surface-level change in perspective from one autocrat to another, but the details of the story stay the same. He claims the title of the Kwisatz Haderach, the one who can see from all angles, but by seeing from all angles, he creates a single point of view not too far removed from the one he replaced. The tower is intact. The torture chamber is still behind the camera, and the bomb is still going to go off. The same people get brutalized. All that's changed is who's doing the brutalizing. Too often, the idea of changing perspective to make a better world does just that. It imagines our existing and horrific power structures with more diverse agents, but fundamentally unchanged. We go from stories exclusively of the white male hero cop to the black hero cop and the woman hero cop, but the cops remain heroic. We see this in our entertainment and our politics. Lori Lightfoot, mayor of Chicago, is a black lesbian, but being from an intersection of marginalized identities has not stopped her from defending and enabling the CPD's violence, primarily against poor black and brown people. I've talked about how a change in perspective without a change in power is not enough. But when the changes in perspective are so tepid, even a shift in power won't make much of a difference. And the features of perspective, the viewer and the viewed, the subject and the object, limit what actual liberation would be. So as we work towards imagining a better world, we have to think of new ways of seeing, new images to form, new languages to speak. In her essay Visual Pleasure, Mulvey is looking for that language. A politically and aesthetically avant-garde cinema is now possible, she says, but it can still only exist as a counterpoint. Instead, she wants us to leave the past behind without simply rejecting it, transcending outworn or oppressive forms, and daring to break with normal, pleasurable expectations in order to conceive a new language of desire. I don't know what that language would sound like. I don't know how this new way of seeing would look. But even within the metaphor of vision, there is space for something beyond vision. There is the darkness behind the watcher, the blindness past the horizon, the unobserved world for which the great tower of perspective means nothing. We may never transcend the power and limitations of sight, but the very idea of the unseen promises that it's possible. That, out there, at the bottom of the sea, there are creatures that have never known eyes. There are desert storms no living being has seen. Before life and long past it, there are stars who are born and burn and fade unwitnessed. A sphere of light glowing in all directions, untouched by a cone of vision. For every image ever perceived, there is a universe behind and beyond it that we will never see. And, perhaps, in that universe past sight, there's a different way. Without viewer and viewed, without subject and object, just a warm, rich darkness that spreads like soft music. And so, as we try to reimagine this world, close your eyes. For a moment, at least. Close your eyes.